Hi, this is Kate Crowley, Professor of Practice here at Teachers College, Columbia University in New York City. Welcome to our Cleft Palate Speech and Feeding video tutorials that I've created with my co-authors, Dr. Miriam Baigorri and Ms. Chelsea Sommer. This is module 3.3, where we look at how to address nasal emissions.
So velopharyngeal dysfunction can lead to nasal emissions. So that would sound like when someone's saying sun and sounds like compensatory misarticulations, which are errors that are learned from having a faulty mechanism. And examples of that are glottal stops, pharyngeal fricatives, pharyngeal stops, mid-dorsum palatal stops, and nasal rustles. And then there are also obligatory misarticulations. And those are errors that are caused because there's a structural or physiological reason for it. And those aren't corrected through therapy, those are corrected through surgery. So let's talk about nasal emissions. Nasal emissions may be inaudible, so you won't be able to hear them, but when you put a dental mirror under their nose, you'll be able to see the mirror fog up. And that would let you know that there's air coming out of their nose and it's fogging up the mirror. They may be audible, so when the child says a word with a high pressure sound like sun, you actually hear it, so they may say sun. Nasal emissions can be obligatory, and this may be caused by a structural or physiological reason. So maybe there's a hole, there's a fistula in the child's mouth that's leading that air, that sound, to come out of their nose. Or a nasal emission can be learned. So this may be because they've had a cleft palate, they've had a fistula, they had poor velopharyngeal closure, and then it's gotten repaired, but they've learned how to make these sounds through their nose versus their mouth, and then these are errors that you can work on in therapy.
Watch a choo-choo.
Watch a choo-choo.
Mm-hmm.
You got it.
George saw Gigi.
George saw Gigi.
Good. Good.
So what do you do with nasal emissions in therapy? Well, you may want to show the child the difference between a nasal sound and oral sound. They need to become aware that when you talk, most of your sounds come out of your mouth, not out of your nose. So you might have a visual. You might have a picture of a clown with a big nose and with their lips and a bow tie. And when the child makes a sound like the word hm coming out of their nose, you'll say, hmm, you know what? I think that came out of their nose. But when they say it out of their mouth, like sun, they'll say, hey, pointing to the mouth, that came out of the clown's mouth. Good job. And then you may model a few times. Now, where do you think this came out of? I'll say the word, hm, and the child will be able to detect the difference and say, hmm, that was a nose. And then you'll say, sun, and they'll point to the clown's mouth and they'll say, that was a mouth sound. And you'll want to encourage mouth sounds. Also, you could use a mirror. So if you put a mirror under the child's nose and they say sun, but they're saying with a nasal emission, the incorrect way, when they say sun, hun, and it comes out of their nose, the mirror will fog up.
So what you're going for is no fogging. So you'd go place the mirror between your nose and your mouth. And there'll be no fogging. And if they're having a lot of nasal emission, it's going to look like this. I'm not sure if you can see the emission. So there's going to be fogging. So that's just a visual for the child to know that there's air coming out through the mouth.
When using the mirror test, be careful with vowels, because sometimes vowels may fog up the mirror. So try to avoid vowels. So if you say, try to avoid using the vowel next to the P, or with the S sound. So say S instead of saying sa, because that vowel next to the S may fog up the mirror and then the child will be confused. So avoid using the vowel when you accompany the consonant.
Two, two.
Can you do that one more time? And I'm going to hold this under your notes to see if you have any air coming out, okay? Two, two.
Two, two.
Okay, there was a little bit. Let's just try saying the sound itself, the t. One more time. All right, you see there's a little bit and then it goes away. So this is another way that you can practice at home with the mirror, okay?
So now what I want you to do is say, Very nice. Say s. A little bit of nasal emission. Give me s. Give me sissy.
Sissy.
Good. Give me s.
Also, you may want to plug the child's nose. By plugging the child's nose, you're kind of directing the airstream into the child's mouth. So if you occlude their nostrils and have them say the sound, it'll come out of their mouth versus their nose. So if they tend to go like that, you occlude it, it'll force the air out of their mouth versus their nose.
Buy baby a bib.
Buy baby a bib.
Again.
Buy baby a bib.
Keep going.
So when using this method of plugging the child's nose, be careful with it. You don't want the child to rely on plugging his nose when he's talking. You rather the child learn the difference between an oral sound and a nasal sound. When you're plugging the child's nose, you don't want to be too invasive, and so you may want to gently touch the child's nose this way. And then as the child becomes more aware other nasal versus oral sounds, you might want to fade the nose plugging by gradually moving upward and outward of the nose. So moving it up so they're not relying on your fingers pressing against their nostrils that much. There are certain sounds that are affected more than others by nasal emissions. So let's say the child has a nasal emission for the sound S. So when they're saying S, they're saying S. If the child can make a T, you could use the T to facilitate the production of an S. So have them say the T sound and elongate it to create the S, sort of like this. That'll direct the airflow out of the mouth versus the nose.
So again, because the T and the S are made in the same place, so by making the T first, that helps with directing the airflow out because the child's tongue is already in position for this sound.
Right, I get that.
Yes, and also with tapping on the arm, and you can tap on her arm as well, so they can feel that like continuous airflow. And again, if you do a t, you can feel the air a lot out of the mouth, so that might be a good visual just to start off and introduce the sound to her, saying, you know, for this sound, we want all the air to come out of our mouth instead of our nose.
Okay. Ready, guys, let's do another one.
Excellent.
So that's the end of Module 3.3 on nasal emissions. For more information, you can go to leadersproject.org.